Right, good morning, everybody. Lovely to have you with us this morning, and we're gonna have. Yeah, I'm on. Is it not loud enough? Oh, there we go. I'm meeting it. That sounds very loud. We are here today to have a good time and learn more about Jesus. I hope you've had a good week. We've had a good week. Uriah is now 3, so that was very exciting this week. I'm just going to look at the notices. There was a mistake on last week's notice. Said the PCC was on the 7th of March. It isn't. It's on the 14th of March. So please pray for that. On the back where it says, please pray for, we have some sad news. So since the notices were printed, Pat, Helen's mum, has passed away. So please remember Helen's family and Pat's family when you are praying this. During this week. And then a small reminder that Val told me about Sue Aiton's funeral will be at 10:30 on Wednesday at Holton Price Crematorium. So if any of you know or knew Sue and would like to go to that, that's 10:30 Wednesday, Holton Price Crematorium. I think everything else you can read. Oh, I'll notice, I've just seen this one, so I'll tell you. Just read it. Please read it. So there's a notice about the electoral roll in the corner here. So that's an important one for the AGM, which is coming up in April. So just make sure you've read that and you do anything that it asks you to if you haven't already done it. ECC. You said about PCC, what else?
Living in love and faith.
Oh, on Thursday. Sorry. Yes, on Thursday, you all will be aware, I'm sure, of Living in Love and Faith and the decision that the General Synod made the other week. We're not covering that again. That decision's been made. But if you've got questions that you want to ask about Living in Love and Faith and what that entails, then please come here on Thursday at 7:30, and we're going to have Matthew Brailsford, who's leading this Q&A session. He did it down at his church. They found it really useful. And then we have Tim is going to talk about what actually happened at the General Synod, and we've also got a representative from Living Out, and he's going to he's got his viewpoint that he would like to share with you as well. So if you are interested in that, you want to come and ask questions that you have, please come on Thursday at 7:30, and that's here. That's everything. If that's really confused you, just read the notices. So I just wanted to share a psalm with you this morning. As I was getting up this morning, I thought, I really want to have a few kind of psalm kind of words floating around my head. So I opened my Bible, and this is what I found in the Psalms. And I'm not sure which one. Let's do Psalm 117. It's only 2 verses long. Praise the Lord, all you nations. Extol him, all you peoples. For great is his love towards us, and the faithfulness of the Lord endures forever. Praise the Lord. So there are some amazing words that God is with us, and we can praise him forever, and his love will never fade and never go away. So let's think about those as we join together in song. Thanks, Nigel.
I'm
by the prayer and discipline of Lent, may we enter into the mystery of Christ's sufferings, and by following in his way, come to share in his glory. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. And then we're going to say sorry for things that we have done, said, thought this week that we are ashamed of. We know we've made people sad, hurt people. We bring all those things to God now. We lay them at his feet so that they can be forgotten and forgiven. Most merciful God, Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, we confess that we have sinned in thought, word, and deed. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbours as ourselves. In your mercy, forgive what we have been. Help us to amend what we are and direct what we shall be, that we may do justly, love mercy, and walk humbly with you, our God. Amen. Solomon. Can't see, who's there? Solomon, it's you're up. Solomon's going to bring our reading to us today. It's taken from John 3. We're reading from verse 1 to 17.
Now there was a man of the Pharisees named Nicodemus, member of the Jewish ruling council. He came to Jesus at night and said, Rabbi, we know you are a good teacher who has come from God, for no one could perform the miracles, signs you are doing if God were not with him. In reply, Jesus declared, I tell you the truth, no one can see the kingdom of God unless he is born again. How can a man be born when he is old? Nicodemus asked. Surely he cannot enter the second time in his mother's womb to be born. Jesus answered, I tell you the truth. No one can enter the kingdom of God unless he is born of the water and the spirit. Flesh gives birth to flesh, but the spirit gives birth to spirit. You should not be surprised to my saying, you must be born again. The wind blows wherever it pleases. You hear the sound, its sound, but you cannot tell where it comes from or where it's going. It is going. So it is with everyone born of the Spirit. How can this be? Nicodemus asked. You are Israel's teacher, said Jesus, and you do not understand these things. I tell you the truth, we speak of what we know, and we testify what we have seen. But still, you people do not accept our testimony. I have spoken to you of early things, and you do not believe. How then will you believe if I speak of heavenly things? No one has ever gone into heaven except the one who came from heaven, the Son of Man. Just as Moses lifted up the snake in the desert, so the Son of Man must be lifted up, that everyone who believes in him may have eternal life. For God is so loved by the world, that he gave his one and only Son, that whoever believes in him shall not perish but have eternal life. For God did not send his Son to the world to condemn the world, but to save the world through him. This is the word of the Lord.
Thank you, Solomon. That was very well read. Sue's going to come and speak to us. So, Sue, Lord, we just pray for Sue as she comes up here. We pray that you will bless her with the words that we need to hear. We pray that you will give her clarity of mind and that we will learn new things about you in these next few minutes, moments. Amen.
I hope I'm on. Oh, I am. This is my Mary Poppins bag. Before I open it, can I ask all the children to come down to the front? And this is amazing because I didn't ask for it, but every one of these chairs here seems to be vacant. I'm looking, so I'm expecting a few visitors down here. Look at that, girls. There are three there if you want them, or over there. Where do you fancy? All right, as I said, this is my Mary Poppins bag, and I've put some things in it. And I've done that because I want you to try and remember what you see. That's everybody, but particularly these at the front. Because at the end, I'm going to ask you just a few questions. And I always think it's better if you've got something to look at. It gives you a reminder, doesn't it? Have you seen this? This is what I mean by my Mary Poppins bag, because it's full of things, but I don't lose anything because I can just pull it tight and I can carry a lot round it. I just don't have the other things that she had in her bag. Right, I'm going to ask you a question. What has a lantern? A bowl? A cross? A very strange packet that has, have a look, has some very strange writing on it. If I take it out and just open it slightly, you'll see that it's material that's got blue colour and a silver colour. And look at that there. What has a pack of balloons and that's just a weight, but this is as close as I could get a jar of spices and a very large snake. What have they all got in common? Have a think about it as I try and tell you a story that I love. If there are any men here, can you put your hand up if you went to men's breakfast yesterday? I've fallen out with every one of you. Right? I shall not speak to you when you have your coffee. And he came home yesterday from the men's breakfast and he broke the news to me that on Netflix Netflix, there's a series called The Chosen, and episode 7 was all about this bloke called Nicodemus. Well, that was a bit awkward because this story is about that very man. My version may be slightly different from the dramatized version that you saw yesterday, but I hope I'm asking many of the same questions. Now, I know that some of you know this, but perhaps the most important and well-known and the most memorized verse of the entire Bible is found within this account that Solomon read so well to us. John 3:16. I wonder if any of you down here can remember that verse. It begins, "For God." Can you remember it? "For God so loved the world that he gave his only Son, that whoever believes in him should not perish, should not die, but have everlasting life." When I became a Christian, that was the verse you had to learn. You learnt it so you could remember it forever. And it's there in the middle of this story about a man. It sums up salvation in a few words: God's love for the world, his gift of his only Son, and the opportunity for anyone who believes in him to have eternal life. God's love is reaching out and drawing other people in. God offers us a pattern of true love. If we love somebody dearly, the way that we all do, whether it's your brother, sister, mum, dad, wife, husband, if we love someone dearly, we will give freely. God gave us his only Son, and he was a sacrifice. Jesus accepted our punishments and offers us new life, the life he bought for us. It's a bit like when you're very small and you have to sit on the naughty step, a bit like this one. Jesus sat on the naughty step for us, and he gave us new life. So why does this vital verse come at the end of a passage about a night visit, by a religious leader called Nicodemus? Who was he? What did he want from Jesus? Do we know anything about this man? We probably don't. Some people remember he was a man who asked Jesus what they thought was a stupid question. But what we discover is that he was a learned man and a Pharisee. He had got amazing credentials. That meant that he was pretty important because he was a member of the Jewish ruling council. He must have been aware that Jesus and the Pharisees didn't get on very well. John the Baptist and Jesus himself criticized the Pharisees and called them hypocrites. There was opposition from Pharisees to Jesus. So what was Nicodemus' intention? And why did he come when it was dark? There are many suggestions. Was it the only time Nicodemus had to spare? Was he worried about what his peers might think? Did Nicodemus think that his time with Jesus might be interrupted by all the crowds that followed Jesus? Would he be in danger if he was found to be in a secret meeting? Perhaps he was cautious or just plain scared. Surely there was a man here that was out of reach. He wouldn't have wanted Jesus' salvation, surely. He was never going to change. He got his theology all sewn up. Many commentators suggest he was frightened of being discovered. Did he lack courage and conviction? Was he unwilling to be seen with Jesus? Pharisees were often jealous of Jesus because he undermined their authority and he challenged their views. He didn't agree with them. He told them they were wrong. Maybe Nicodemus really wanted to learn, but he was afraid of what his friends might think. Certainly he seemed to be unwilling to be seen with Jesus, unless it was in the dark. When he gets there, he starts talking to Jesus. He begins the conversation. And as soon as he speaks, he says to Jesus, "You've been sent by God." And he tells him, "I know this because of all the signs, all the wonders, all the miracles, everything you've done tells me that you've been sent by God." He uses the word "we," that means in the plural, more than one, when he says in verse 3, "Rabbi, Rabbi, we," that's all the Pharisees, "know that you've come from God." Nicodemus thinks he understands who Jesus is and who God is. Jesus questions his understanding, though, and he says, "Well, the signs and wonders only prove to anyone that I've come from God. But it doesn't tell you about God's ultimate plan." Nicodemus's perception is partially incomplete, but he's attracted to Jesus's character. Then Jesus tells Nicodemus something very strange. He said, "You can't see God's reign unless you're born again." The word is from Greek, anathen, and it means again, but it also means from above. Unless Nicodemus understands that flesh comes from flesh and spirit comes from spirit, he'll never understand how God is working. And he says, how can anybody who's old, that's like a lot of us here, ever be born again? We can't get inside our mum's tummy and appear again. And Jesus gives him a very strange answer. He said, "Those who are born again become spiritual beings. They're not babies like Mary. They're spiritual beings. They don't have to go back into their mum's tummy. It's like the spirit who breathes life into them. We can't control the spirit. He's like the wind. He goes wherever he wants to. You can feel it, but you don't know where it's come from, and you have no idea where it's going. And when we're born, if you think back, I bet none of you can actually remember when you were born. You had no control over when you were born. And we can't control our spiritual birth, because it comes through the breathing, the wind of the Holy Spirit." In verse 10, Nicodemus still doesn't understand, and Jesus wonders how this teacher of Israel can fail to understand such things. And he tells Nicodemus that what appears impossible to humans is easily possible with God. In verses 11 and 12, Jesus reminds him that he's talked and testified to all these things, but nobody believed it. So if he doesn't accept earthly things, how can Nicodemus accept this heavenly teaching? Jesus is challenging him to start a new life. Nicodemus is a really clever man, and he knows the Old Testament very well. So, in verses 14 and 15, Jesus reminds him of a time when the Israelite people wandered round and round the wilderness, moaning at God. They were moaning because God had sent manna from heaven for them to eat. And they were moaning. They didn't like it. Couldn't they have something else? It was always manna. They were moaning, and God got pretty upset. So he sent a plague of snakes. Anyone who was going to die from the bite from the snake could be healed by obeying God. All they had to do was to look up at the bronze snake that Moses had set up and believe that God would heal them, and they were healed. You can find that in Numbers, the old ones, if you want to look it up. He tells them that the Son of Man, Jesus, that's him, would also need to be lifted up. And we need to lift our eyes up to the crucified Jesus and believe that he will save us. God's way gives us a way out from sin's deadly bite. This new life begins now, in the moment that we accept Jesus as our Saviour and trust our lives to him. When believers get eternal life, they enter God's reign in the here and now. Citizenship in this new place is not solo. It's not me on my own, or you on your own. We belong to a whole body, the whole body of Christ. It's not that we have to learn it in our head, but we have to trust Jesus' words, because we can rely on him. He's in charge of our present and our future. Nicodemus is only mentioned 3 times in the Bible. He doesn't say anything more to Jesus. We suspect that he just went off home. But he is mentioned once that I think is really important. After Jesus was crucified, Joseph of Arimathea and Nicodemus, who had become, we think, secret followers of Jesus. They didn't want anybody to know because they were important people in the Jewish community. But it was those two who asked for Jesus' body. They were the ones that got Jesus' body, and they brought along myrrh, you'll have heard of that, and aloes for Jesus' burial. They were the ones that wrapped Jesus' body, put all the spices in, and wrapped it up in linen. It was risky. It was dangerous for them. But it showed that they had a change of heart. They were beginning to think about Jesus and what he'd said. Jesus invites us all to receive life as God's gift. The crucified Son of God shows us God's love. He was scorned, he was rejected, he was killed, but he was triumphant. He came out the winner. Nicodemus should be an example to us. I like him. For all his learning, for all his doubts, for all his moving around in the dark, he was the one there with Joseph of Arimathea who did a great service for Jesus. When Jesus was dead and brought down from the cross, he was the one that looked after the body the way the Jews looked after the body when people died. The ladies came on the Sunday with the same idea. Do you know, I'd love to have been there when Nicodemus realised that the tomb was empty. Because I think he might have been really happy when he realised that Jesus had been lifted up and put in the ground for a prison. I want to ask you a question then. What on earth does all this have to do with this man Nicodemus? What do you reckon? Why have I got a lantern?
It represents the Holy Spirit.
It could do. What about in this particular story? You're right, it could do. Yeah, and who might have needed the lantern then?
Me.
Yeah, because he went in the dark, didn't he? He might have needed a light to see where he was going. What about a bowl? Why have I brought the bowl? If I bring the bowl and that together, you might remember, what did Jesus say about when you're born again? What did he say? How do you get born again? What's being born again got to do with a bowl and a balloon? How did he say you got born again? With, what will I put in there? I could put loads of things in on there, but what could I put in there from the tap? Water. He said you were born again of water. He didn't say water in the balloon. Air? What do I have to do to get air in there? Well, if I blow, I don't know, I used to be good at this. Let's see if I can still do it. Excuse me, dear, I think you've probably got more puff than I have. He said we're born of water and of the Spirit. And he said the Spirit's like what? What did he say the Spirit was like? He said it comes and it goes. Air, or what's it, that other word, wind. Good. If I do this, it's gone. It goes wherever it wants, just like the Spirit goes wherever it wants. Okay, so I bet you know what this is all about. Absolutely, the bronze snake held up high. Look at that. And trust in God, and the snake bite won't kill you. So what's a snake got to do with a cross? Who was lifted up on this?
Jesus.
He was lifted up. Look at him. And you will be saved. I told you I haven't got any of the real stuff. But what's this? What did I say it was? That's right. The spices to wrap up with his body. I found on... Yeah, myrrh. I haven't got any myrrh. I don't think we put it in our puddings anymore. So we brought that. But I brought this as well, not because they wrapped them in sugar, but because this is a weight. And when I looked on the internet, I discovered that Nicodemus brought with him, to wrap around the body of Jesus on the cloth and rub into his skin, 30 kilos of myrrh and aloes. That's 30 bags of that. I bet that was costly. I bet it took a long time to prepare that body for burial. I brought one last thing. I said he had very strange writing. I wonder whether you can guess where that writing comes from, what that writing is. No, not quite, but you're in the right place. Yeah, Hebrew. I bought this in Israel. Who can I borrow? You come in. Yeah. It's got writing on the end. I can't think what it is, but I won't guess. I'm going to put it round.
What is this for?
Okay, that's a very good question. I wonder if you can guess, out of that story, who might have worn this? It's very obvious, and I'll give you a clue, it wasn't Nicodemus. Yeah, tell me.
Joseph.
Not Joseph.
Jesus.
And that he called him, Nicodemus called him a special word. Can anybody remember what it was? It began with an R. He said, well, that's brilliant. Edwin, well done, Rabbi. This is what a rabbi, that is a bit like a vicar here. This is what a rabbi wore and still wears in the Jewish synagogue now. Rabbi, teacher. Does it feel good now? It's good, isn't it? So all these things have something very much to do with our story of Nicodemus, the man who was perhaps a little frightened to go and meet Jesus, but when he got there, he discovered that Jesus could change his life. And I guess that Jesus really did change his life, especially when we think of all of those packets or boxes or jars of myrrh that they took to prepare Jesus' body for burial. Sing together, Mario. Sing together in response to that. That was really interesting. So Nigel's going to lead us in a couple of songs. Those children of mine that are going to take the offering, we're going to do that in the second song.
Thank you. We have had the opportunity to share with everybody any praise or thanks that you want to. So we'll do that first. So anybody that's got anything that they want to share, that God's done, they want to say thank you for, raise a hand.
All the glory this morning, all the praise, and all the thanksgiving. So.
Monday. Next Monday, it's right in the news. Next Monday is getting wings. Anybody else want to say thank you to God before we carry on with our prayers? You. What then? Service with one final song. There will be coffee and tea and hot chocolate afterwards, so please do stay and have a chat. Thank you.
Passes all understanding. Keep our hearts and minds in the knowledge and love of God and of his Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be among us and remain with us always. Amen. And go in peace to love and serve the Lord.
In the name of Christ.
Amen.